Good evening. One of the things that we promoted in CD a long time ago was sit and talk, so that the capture will be easy and use you know, either a document projection camera or slides that allows the faculty member to see the audience while talking. Whereas if I write on the blackboard, that camera will capture my back and I will also not be able to, the instructor will not be able to see the audience. As a matter of fact, we convinced some mathematics professors who generally like to write on the board to you know, try it out, and then this person said that at the end of the course he really liked it, and he offered one more course as well. Of course, he used the document projection camera. You write on this and then this whole thing gets projected. There are many benefits. We did some marketing to promote this. That marketing I don't have to do now because we are not talking about that mechanism. So I am really delighted to be here, and also delighted to be in this room, because this room was put together during when I was the head of CD, and even the benches here, I wanted this to be slightly wider so that two students can sit and write the exam comfortably. As a matter of fact, they gave a wrong bench, and then I fought with them and got it changed. So although the title is flipped classroom, I thought I will spend a few minutes on clickers, and then I will go to flip method. I will spend maybe just about 5 minutes in clickers. Clickers, in my opinion, are the most proven method that came out of educational technology research. So what is a clicker? This is what is used by Amitabh Bachchan in the earliest avatar of Kon Banega Crorepati to all the participants used to click their answers, A, B, C, D, or 1, whatever. And this device helps understand, this device, this method helps us find out whether the students have understood whatever we are teaching. That is extremely important, because there were times when at the mid-semester exam, I had found out that the students had not understood. They had not understood the meaning of root locus. I went on to teach how to design controllers using root locus when they had not understood root locus. Some simple definition they had not understood. And of course, when you teach, you ask the students, you ask them, have you understood? They will say yes. And if you just look at them, they will nod their head, not because they understand, but because nodding is something that faculty members like, so the students nod. This is something I found out. So what do? Identify immediately those who do not understand concepts and take corrective actions. Do not wait till exams. It turned out when I tried this clickers, there was also going to be a MOOCs. I was delivering a live lecture at the time, and one of my former students had a startup, and he was going to make available MOOCs. He wanted my course as MOOCs, massive open online course, and he wanted, because it was meant for millennials whose concentration span is very short, he said, can you make your videos short, like 10 minutes, 15 minutes? So what I did in that live lecture was in that year, I would divide the concepts that I would teach in a class to like 3, 4. So every time, every day, I would begin by saying, today I have 4 things to teach, or 3 things to teach, and these are the 3 things, 1, 2, 3, 4. So each one will be much shorter. Of course, that requires a lot more work, dividing that into concepts. at the end of one topic, I'll say, okay, first topic is over. Now I'm going to ask you a question. So at that time, we had given Akash tablets to every student, and that was used as clickers. So they would immediately open, and then there was a break in monotony, which they liked, and they would answer the question. And this, of course, can be implemented without any technology. One can, Sahana always says that you can ask the students to say this, 1, 2, 3, 4, 3. Then you can just have a look at this and find out, or is everybody saying the same answer? You expect the answer to be 2. If most of the people are saying 2, then it is fine, right? They have understood the concept. Okay. And of course, there is also nowadays you can use mobile phones. In places where they don't permit mobile phones, one can even use cards. There is a software called Plickers, clickers with a P for paper. That's a very nice software. You can just take a printer, it like a QR code, they will all have it, and then A, B, C, D. And then with your mobile phone, you can actually scan, and then you will get histogram, and then you get the same idea without technology. Okay. So what is the method? Ask a question, poll the answers, find out how many people answered A, how many people answered B, and so on. If most students answer correctly, then it is okay, go to the next topic. Spend the available few minutes to teach some advanced topics. You could, for example, you could always say that I'm going to have extra 1 or 2 minutes for that topic. That extra time is available in case students don't understand, I will go and explain that. So I have that extra time. But people have understood. Now you can spend that time to teach some advanced concepts. If not, this happened half the time, I was surprised. Half the time students had not understood. I thought I explained it and everybody nodded, but they had not understood. Allow the students to talk to their neighbors. Say, okay, talk to, because you see A, B, C, D all equal. Okay, only the answer, only one is correct. Then they will talk to each other, including those who guessed it. They will talk to they know who knows the answer. We don't know. Okay, of course, at the time of grading, they will say, look, I know it, even if it is a guess. But here they will go and find out what the correct answer is. And when it will be noisy for a while, afterwards it becomes quiet, then you know that they have done the discussion, and then you do the poll again. Find out once again. Okay, now I'm going to, you have to choose A, B, C, D once again. And most of the time, they got them right. Most of the time, almost 90% of the time, they would have found the answer from the person who knows. You would have convinced them. If many answer correctly, you go to the next topic. If not, there were times when I still got equidistribution or two options, B and D. And they were unable to figure out which is the correct answer. Then you have to explain why that is the wrong answer, why the answer is wrong. So you have to explain 1 or 2 minutes. And I thought that this really helped. Of course, at the end of the semester, I gave the recording to the student who cut at each of them and said this is 10 minutes, 15 minutes. It served that purpose also, right, for the MOOCs. So clicker method is something that I would strongly recommend. It is something that we can use immediately because it helps find out whether the students are with us or whether we have lost them. Okay. I'm telling this because I have had bad experience many times. Okay. Next I will go to the flipped classroom, which is the main topic for today's lecture. The outline is as follows, flipped method and its benefits. I will want to point out the shortcomings of flipped method, addressing the shortcomings, and then how did we implement it, what marking scheme was used, etc. And then perception analysis, and then I am going to present some evidence. Most of you would have heard of this flipped classroom method. learning happens outside the classroom. In a normal conventional method of teaching, the instructor teaches, students, most of the students listen to it the first time. They are exposed to the topic in the class and they go to the hostel, go home, wherever it is, and then they explore it further, discuss it, solve problems and you know things like that. Additional learning happens outside the classroom. In a flipped method, just the opposite happens. The students are supposed to go through the material and come to the class. So going through the material could convey, it does not restrict one to a video, for example. It could be a book. You could say that read that section and come to the class, read that chapter and come to the class. Or some faculty member from such and such university has given an excellent lecture, see that and come. Or I am going to follow an NPTEL course in this. There is a great person who has delivered a fantastic NPTEL course, I am going to use that as the course material. Students have to see the video and come to the class. Okay. Even though it is not a video that I have created, I would like to use that. Okay. This is especially useful for beginning teachers. They can find out somebody who is very good and use that. It could be used, one can even say that do a survey and come, read some newspaper and come. I mean, especially for sociology class and so on, it could be literature survey and then coming to class and you know stuff like that. Anything is possible. So in a flipped method, just the opposite happens. They are supposed to do the reading outside the class and come to the class to further discuss or to get the doubts cleared and things like that. So that is what the classroom period is for. So learning happens outside the classroom. Classroom is for discussions, problem solving and so on. Its benefits are well known because the students can learn at their own speed, at a convenient time and you know so on. And some students learn very fast, they can do it quickly. Some other students learn slowly. If they have to go through the video, they can, somebody can rewind it 2-3 times, especially those students who may be not very fluent in English, they can listen to the video 2-3 times. Okay. Now in a flipped classroom, the other thing is, in a normal classroom we say that look, the classroom is big, there is no eye contact, I am unable to see the student. In a flipped classroom, when they go through the video, every student watches the video and it is one-on-one, very close. So there is no problem of losing the eye contact and the class time is used for discussion, asking a question and people answering, and you get to see them, you get to talk to them because use the class time for that purpose. So that is why I am saying its benefits are well known and a lot of people, there has been a lot of literature on this. So the benefits, to summarize, study at a convenient time and place, study at a comfortable pace, reuse instructional material. This is very important for our country where there is a shortage of good faculty members. A good faculty member creates a good course and gives it to people, a lot of people can use it. Okay. It can be used by TAs in the reruns of a course. It can be used, here of course I am assuming that we have created a video, good video, because it is going to be used in a flipped mode and people can use it again and again. And of course at the time of exams, people can of course go through it. So it is very useful. The work is more because you have to create the video first, but then once it is done, thousands can use it. And by the way, MOOCs is a generalization of a flipped method. Only difference is, in a flipped method, all students come here. In MOOCs, even that happens in a distributed fashion. Otherwise, videos are there, short videos are there, discussion happens through some forum and things like that, which is possible in the flipped method also. So in fact, flipped method predates the MOOCs MOOCs is a generalization. And of course, MOOCs assumes that there is a video. In flipped method, video is not required. One can use a textbook, for example. So benefits in the Indian context, flipped method is scalable, useful in the Indian context, can use for several hundreds at a time. Young teachers can also be effective, and they can use various OER, and of course they can use their own. And this is another, this is a major problem in our situation, especially in other colleges. In IITs also we have last minute cancellation of a class, holidays, and you know, things like that. I will explain to you how we so how that doesn't affect us in the flipped method. It can easily be handled. I have had many situations wherein towards the end of the class you have too many things to teach because you lost many classes. So that can easily be accommodated here. So these are the benefits of the flipped method. Now I am going to talk about, so lot of things, a lot of papers, a lot of people have used it and so on, but there are also some shortcomings. So how did I find out? Okay, before that, some papers that actually said bad things about flipped method. So I will present both sides, then you can decide. Okay. So this was a paper that came from nursing school in Texas A&M, and they tried three different methods. One is regular classroom, the second one was regular classroom with video recording also made available. That is the second one. And the third one was flipped method. In that regular, it was not a regular class, they already recorded maybe in the previous year and they gave it to students, they were supposed to see and come, there was no classroom instruction. Instruction has to be done through the videos only, that is a flipped method. Okay, compared with conventional method with recording backup, flipped method was liked the least by students, although the learning was the best. I have written better than other two methods, it was the best. They better because they scored high marks and class average was much higher, but the students hated it. Students hated the flipped method. You could have guessed why. Excessive work is the reason. Okay, that you know, you have to study for 3 hours and come to the class for 3 hours. And in fact, I will tell you what happened in our UG class. And there are some other papers, and some people say that some people try to give too much reading assignment. In the 3 hours you read and come, they may have to study for 5 hours. You may end up giving lot more work. In fact, this person says that even some institutions that have mediocre teachers get by giving lot of work. Okay, it's a way out. Okay, so people don't say that teacher is bad, no, too much work, the complaint is something else. Okay, so this is one of the problems. And of course this person says, I stopped teaching using the flipped method as she did not want to overload her students. Okay, now some other person, this person Danker, says for the flipped method to work, it is important that the students take the responsibility. Students should see the material and come to the class, read the material and come to the class. So what happens is, by studying the material ahead of the class, and suppose there is a small percentage of students who don't come prepared, you can always put them in a group of other students who have gone through the material. So you can divide the class into groups of 3, 4, and you know, things like that. There is one fellow in this, that's okay. Okay, we'll fail if majority of the students do not come prepared. This is the problem in IIT context, in Indian context we will have this situation, and I learned this the hard way, so I'm sharing that with you, and we found a way to overcome that. So cooperation of students is required. So if everybody comes unprepared, then there is a problem. I taught the digital control course to PG students through flipped method for few years. This was before I tried this UG thing, several years. In fact, I started in 2017, I have taught 11, 12 years now, flipped method PG. In fact, I still remember the very first time I tried, there were 6 students from Ethiopia. Out of that, 2 students dropped out saying that, look, looks like I will not learn anything in this course because he is not going to teach anything here. They dropped out of the course. Whereas the students who stayed back and said, oh, this is too much work, because it is actually more work in a flipped method for the student as well as for the teacher. So for the PGs it worked quite well, but later in one of the years mostly undergraduates took that course, especially dual degree students in our department. So I am talking about world story when we had dual degree, many students, they took that course. There were times when no one came prepared, nobody read, and I would not be teaching, the whole method would fail. It will happen here, I am telling you. Video, yeah, I had given videos, I had in fact used videos, because remember I used the clickers, so at that time it was recorded live, and in fact I improved the videos further next year, and then I released those videos. So in my class they used my videos, my examples and so on, that way it was a lot easier for me. Yeah, good question. The question is whether I had a digital control book. Yes, I had, I wrote that book. In fact 2007 is the year when it got published. That was the year when I started the flip method, because the book is there, videos were there and things like that. So excessive load was given as the reason, 3 hours of video watching and 3 hours of classroom interaction, they said it is too much work. So I said that I still want to do flip method because of the benefits it offers in the Indian context, because I was heading CD, I always at CD we always thought about how to make our instruction available to a larger audience, how to make whatever we do in IIT useful to lots of students, can we benefit lots of people, right. I wanted the flip method to succeed, right. So I said I have to make it work, what should I do. So if this is the main reason, 3 hours of video watching and 3 hours of classroom interaction, if that is too big, can I still address this and have flip method. I wanted to have flip method, I wanted it to be effective, and obviously students had to come. How to make the students come to the class, how to convince them that flip method is not too much work. So in the next year what I did was, I said I had 36 1-hour videos recorded in the previous live classroom, it was recorded in CD, I had 36 1-hour videos. At the beginning of this flip method I said this is the portion, 36 hours, okay. Now one might say that 36 hours is less than let us say 42 hours that we normally teach and so on, but it turns out there is a difference between the way you would teach in a live class as opposed to teaching through video recording. In a video recording you do not have to repeat things, you can say see the previous video and come, right. In fact I have seen some NPTEL courses, some of them are very boring because they keep repeating when the student can rewind the video and listen to it, right. So your methodology has to be different. So if you teach it properly, 36 hours is lot more than what we teach, because sometimes we spend almost 15 minutes in a class summarizing what we did in the previous class, all that need not be there. So it is possible to keep it really, because even when I taught previously it was live recorded, and we had a scheme by which all recordings would come before the second hour, that means I do not have to rewind, I will say you must, if you miss the class see the video and come to the class, and everybody should see the video and come to the class. So as a result I did not do much of repetition. So 36 hours, 36 1-hour videos and 3 videos per week. So I would say that every week the students should go through 3 videos, and that was the portion for that week, okay. And I said, okay, I will meet you only once. I will come to the class only once. Okay. Remaining time, let us use Moodle. Moodle for discussions. Ask your questions. And I can have office hours. I will be available. If you have a question, you come. Okay. And when you come to the class, I will conduct a quiz on the previous week's portion. In fact, this is something somebody said. What should I do if flipped classroom, flipped method has to succeed? You have to make the students responsible. We saw that word before also. So, quiz. Every time there was a quiz. Discussion in the remaining period, Moodle based discussions outside the class. In addition, I said that in a MCQ, I can only ask short questions, but I am going to conduct big quiz. I am going to show you the marking and so on shortly, wherein they will have to solve a problem. So I used to three big quiz, and of course there was a mid-sem exam, end semester exam. I also had a virtual lab, so I asked them to do three experiments. But at the end of all this, some students came and complained that they didn't realize that they would be doing so badly, okay, whether I could give an optional project. So I said fine, I gave a 5-mark project. So this was the weightage, 10 weekly quiz, 10 marks, 3 big quiz, 10 marks each, 30 marks, virtual lab, total weightage of 10 marks, mid semester exam 25 marks, end semester exam 25 marks, additional project 5, it was 105. So this was the marking scheme I used for the students in the class. So now the answer, there was a I used this in a class of 63 students. This process control course was divided, this was a course on process control. There were two batches. The other batch was taught in the conventional method, and I taught the other half by the flipped method. And if I am not mistaken, our division of the class is such that there are equal number of good students, equal number of low performing students, and you know, so on. So it is a fair division, I would say. Okay. In other words, it is possible to compare as far as the students' background is concerned. And there were mostly males, interestingly 10 to 15% females, which is unusual in an engineering department. Of course, chemical engineering always has had more females. There was a control group, equal number through conventional. Coverage was different in two sections, because we have the freedom in IIT what we teach, and they in the other classroom the portion was, the coverage was slightly different. And it was, but it was possible to do a limited comparison at mid semester, because the portion was common, and so we could ask common questions and we could actually ask them. So what did we do? We we gave two questions for comparison. Question one was one I set based on the way I taught. Question two was taught by the instructor of the other section, and it was made, these were common questions given to both classes. And you can see the group. Unfortunately, I did something wrong, so we did not get the marks of the other section in our for the two things. Then I asked the students, can you please give your papers, I want to note down the marks and give. And obviously I could not enforce, only 24 students gave. I presume that they were better students, so they did not mind sharing their paper, and then we entered the marks and gave it back. And here are the mean marks in the question paper that I set. The question that I set, the it is all maximum was 10. My class average was about 7.5, whereas the other class scored 3.12. In the other question, they scored, my class scored, because this is experimental group, 5. So first is mine, experimental group, the second one is the control group. Both the questions, my students had done better. Okay. Here it is 7.5 versus 3, here it is 5 versus about 4, you can say. And it was statistically very significant. So this is regarding the marks, and then we also did perception analysis, and this is of course restricted to my class where the flipped classroom was, flipped method was used. We, the questioner had the following questions. This activity helped you understand. What are the activities? I'll show you. So activity should be increased, decreased, unchanged, and the amount of work that you had to put in, the amount of work that I had to put in, because we wanted to find out what is it the students felt, what did they feel about this, the effectiveness of the courses because of whatever. Here is the usefulness of the activity. So we asked the question, the following activities helped you understand the intended topics of this course. Weekly quiz. So 77% of the people said yes, it helped, whereas only 2% of the people said no, it didn't help, okay, and 21% of the people said partially. Big quiz, they didn't like it so much, they thought that it didn't help so much, okay. That I didn't ask why it is so, but this was the answer we got. Mid semester exam, many people said that yes, it helped, it helped to understand. Virtual lab, not much. During the discussion stage, we even tried this various things, one was think, pair, share, and they said it was not done very many times, well, once or twice only, so they said it didn't help much. Assignment, of course our students don't like to do assignments, and I also didn't do it. I mean, this is something that I still haven't figured out, how to do the assignments when there is massive copying happening. So this I have not figured out how to solve. So I didn't enforce it, and it was not very effective. Then I asked them how the activities should be changed. So weekly quiz, should I increase, decrease, or should I keep it as it is? So this was the answer. Big quiz, they said, you know, not much this thing, but weekly quiz, they were very sure, it's very good, don't change it. Mid semester exam also was very good. UGs, these are all UGs, these are all the 63 students, which is half of our UG control course. Think, pair, share, they said it should be increased because I did it only one or two sessions. Assignment, they said don't change it, they don't want to do it, okay. Overall, how do you rate the effectiveness of this course compared to a conventional class? More effective 61%, comparable 23%, worse only 15%, okay. And I asked them, how much work did you have to do? Student who find the flipped method comparable to or better than conventional method, say this, they found this either comparable or better, they say 41% say more work. So which means these students, even though the work is more, they didn't mind that, they said it is better, okay. Equal is 23, less is only 36%. I asked the same thing to people who said it is lot worse, okay, they said it is too much work, I hate it, okay, because they have to come prepared. Every week I am conducting a quiz, they have to be on their toes. And I asked, this is very important, I didn't want the students to go and complain to my head, and if the head is bad, then I would be in big trouble, or I mean a taskmaster. What did you think? Do you think that I did more work, less work, or comparable work? Otherwise they will go and say this fellow is having a good time, right, not teaching anything. So this is very important, because we say, remember we told right at the beginning, they have to come prepared, they have to go through the material, you have to convince them. There is quite a bit of marketing involved to sell this idea. So 40% of the people, so majority of the people said that the work was comparable or better. Very few people, only 1/4 of the class thought that I had done less work. Grades, so these are some of the marks, we do not have to go through this, I have a, so this is the average of all the students who scored AA. That is our highest grade, and there were also students who scored FR, I gave, some students got FR marks. Grades versus attendance, okay, I did not have to take attendance, every class I have the question answer paper. So excuse me, that is the attendance. Only here there is a small blip, right, which shows that perhaps says that attending the class is not good enough. Okay, you also have to study further, but generally there is a, you can see a monotonicity, that there is a correlation, right. And we asked the, we found our midterm marks, end term marks were actually higher. So this is something that you know, Sahana suggested that why don't you try this, see if there is a improvement as the semester progressed. So I said let's find out the average marks. Of course this assumes that the question papers are of comparable difficulty, but I thought they were of comparable difficulty, and so I think that it worked okay. We did some correlation. We wanted to, maybe I'll skip this, I'll go a little faster. I wanted to find out a person who does well in weekly quiz, will he or she do well in mid semester, end semester? Similarly, big quiz, if they do well, will they do it in this? And we found excellent correlation. So significant relation. So this alone, weekly quiz performance had significant relationship with big quiz, with mid semester, with end semester. This is extremely important because if somebody asks, what is the guarantee that the students saw the video? Okay. So I tell them this is one indirect proof that I conducted a quiz every week, which was on the basis of the previous week, and not only did they do well in the weekly quiz, they ended up doing well in every further assessment, which could not have been possible if they don't understand the subject. Understanding the subject has to happen through the videos. So that is my way of looking at things, right, because that is extremely important in when we use any new method, we have to validate it. You have to validate it and say that look, I am doing the right thing, right. Before convincing anybody, you have to convince your conscience. Your conscience should be clear, yes, I am doing the right thing. So it is extremely important. What I did was, finally I said out of 12 classes, there were 36, there were 12 weeks, I said I will take only 10. I took the top 10. Okay, if they might have missed it for various reasons, that's okay. Because for me, somebody saying that I was sick and they produce some you know, certificate, as opposed to somebody who says that somebody very close in my family passed away, I had to go. So this shows, if you look at this, you can actually see a big jump here, this to this. They managed to get a DD, CD, DD and so on. But here you see, here it is 66% and here it is 62, and whereas this is 53%. This is a big jump, they lost many classes. I am not saying here that of course one can say that they, look, they didn't, they missed many classes, so they didn't prepare properly, so they also failed in the final exam. Just one mark, it doesn't matter, it doesn't matter, but it gives a very high correlation. It gives a very high correlation because the total number of marks given is only 10 out of 100 for all the 10 weekly quizzes. Okay. So the weightage is not much, there is not too much load on them, but of course students always say, hey, one mark is one mark, I better go prepared, right. And people who took it that way, it helped, and you see the attendance, it is an amazing correlation here, amazing monotonicity, yeah. So the question is, how is the how is it more work for the instructor? The work gets for example, in my case, of course, you know, I am telling you the student's perception, that is the student's perception. I asked the students, do you think I did more work, less work, comparable work? Okay, that is one thing. One thing we had to do was to conduct 12 quiz. Of course, one can say that I am going to use the same quiz paper again and again. But the most difficult thing came, and of course, 3 big quiz, that means I had to set the problem and have them graded, that is definitely extra work. But in most of these methods, the work is upfront, and that is not obvious. I had to create the videos. That's a lot of work. That's a lot of work. Okay. So I have a feeling that the students might have factored that in also, right? So that is a benefit, that if I put in, I don't mind putting in more work, because I may use this method for 3 years. So I don't mind investing double the effort at the beginning, so that it gets over a period of 3 years, it's about the same. So I don't mind doing it. But the benefit to the country is that same video can be used by 1,000 other people. That's why I should do that. The point is that people could use this as a way to reduce the recruitment of teachers. Okay. So in fact, the same thing was mentioned when bank automation came. This bank is going to be automated. Number of people in the, you know, employed in the bank will go down. So there were unions went. But now we know, if you look at statistically speaking, we have many more bank employees. Okay. That is of course not direct comparison, but I am giving a similar example where this happened. Remember what I told you was, there is a big shortage of faculty members. There are colleges wherein BTECs teach BTECs. Okay. It is already happening and we are not doing anything about it. So for them it is going to be very useful. If you look at the classes, it will be amazing. I wouldn't be surprised if in 50% of colleges in India, 50% of teachers are not there. I wouldn't be surprised. So should we not help them immediately? This will help. So we can look at it anyway, right? The question is, if you teach it once, conventional method, can you use it the same thing? Yes, it is possible. Typically what happens is, in CD at that time at least, we encouraged people to deliver the course in front of the camera many times, many times. That come and teach, come and teach. We will do the recording free of cost, right? So typically what happened was, the faculty member would always say, look, I have taught this course 2-3 times, my lectures are very matured now, I don't mind teaching in front of the camera, which can be shared with the public, right? So as a result, although what you say is correct, a lot more work happens before that. Yeah.
If I look at a video of a live lecture, there is audience, there are questions, and the instructor is also not mechanical. He's interesting because he has to deal with the students. So those lectures are very interesting as compared to something that's been done specifically for the camera, where people are talking very slowly and it puts you to sleep. So what do you think about that?
The question is, recording of live lectures is better than purely video, camera, studio delivered courses. I agree with that. My lectures were all classroom lectures. I gave it to them. There have been some interesting experiences happened here, which I will share with you later. But I strongly believe, in fact, I remember somebody talking about one of the faculty members in electrical engineering. Oh, he is such a great teacher, but in a studio course, he was like a caged tiger. Okay. So I agree with you, it is not spontaneous, but we can use that. We do have classes, we can record them, and we can ask the faculty members to improve that. And finally, when they say it is perfect, share it with the public. Yeah, Raja, you had a question.
There are a lot of advantages to talk about, sharing with the less privileged sections of the universities and all. And but what I think, what is very important in my view, which has been reducing over time period, is the self-learning. It is, we have been trying to do with seminars and projects and all those things. I mean, self-learning is something that's going to stay with them forever. I think flipped classroom probably will enable them to go into that direction.
Good point.
And other thing is, when I look at your in-sensor exam, the results are better, because any system people take some time to adapt. Okay? I guess that you got a better results in in-sensor exam because the adaptability for the has been probably matured over time period. They didn't do it. I don't know whether that's correlating with that.
No, good point. Let me repeat so that it gets recorded. Because in fact, that's a good practice. Whenever there is a question and people ask the question without a mic, the speaker should repeat so it gets recorded, because that's one of the things, because we don't have a system in IIT, we are unable to provide a good microphone to every student. By the time the microphone came from that end to this end, the student had forgotten the question. So the point that Raja made is, the most important benefit of flipped classroom seems to be the promotion of self-learning, and that is probably also indicated in this mid-semester exam versus end-semester exam. Possibly, very likely.
What helped them probably in addressing the questions is that they already got into mode of, you know, understanding in a manner. Okay, which they can be a better perspective, you know. So this kind of, you know, any kind of exam, they will be able to address it a little better, even though, you know, the teaching by the both methods, the contents may be the same, the ability of the teachers may be almost the same. And because the guys are learning self-learning, you are able to get better score in your course, because the students are probably trying to look at the subject.
Okay, so I have, I don't know the question, but I will tell you something related to this. I have a feeling that in, at least in IIT Bombay, in IITs, students study in groups. So this fellow will say, okay, let's listen to the, tomorrow there is an exam, let's go through the video. They go through the video and this fellow will suddenly say, hey, I don't know what this guy is saying. So this fellow will pause and explain, okay, this is what happens. So I have a feeling that it also helped group learning, which happens a lot in our hostels, where students who don't know so much tag on to people who know, study together. And I believe that flipped method is actually helpful, especially when you are using videos. They can all listen to it jointly and then help each other and things like that. So the question is it are there procedural difficulties in implementing this? But I don't understand your previous remark about punctuality and so on. What is the context? Oh, you mean our conventional, the feedback form of the conventional method. So basically what you are saying is, in case we decide to adopt this method, our feedback form also should change. Yeah, which I didn't bother, I set up my own. And this thing, doing well in weekly quiz favorably impacts big quiz, mid-semester exam, end-semester exam. Doing well in weekly quiz helps also get good overall score. And as I mentioned earlier, weekly quiz is an indicator of understanding videos. And those who watch videos seem to get good grades. Okay, this is what I concluded. And in fact, this is very important for me. Okay, because Nyquist plot comes at the end of the course, and by the time, I mean, this is the first time so many students got, more than 50 students got the problem correct. Okay, this is for me, as far as I am concerned, students had understood, right. Conclusion, we need to constantly innovate. By the way, let me, I also wrote a paper, this is in fact a conference held in IIT Bombay. International Conference on Learning and Teaching in Computing and Engineering. So it's an IEEE conference that came in 2016. Okay. So that's available. It's so I'll just show the sections: introduction, requirements in the Indian context, sample and method, and then in that sample, limited comparison of experimental and control groups. Instructional method for the flipped classroom, marking scheme for the flipped classroom, and then results, flipped students feedback on various course components, students feedback on the effectiveness of the flipped method, perception of extent of work done by the teaching team, then results, limited comparison, results, impact of regular studies on overall performance of the flipped classroom students. Maybe I didn't cover that. Then results, impact of other evaluation mechanisms. So this was the IEEE paper and it's available. So to conclude, we need to constantly innovate. It is important, given the large numbers of students to teach and given the short span of their attention. It's getting very, very difficult to teach large classes, teaching them, engaging them, and then being unfair to some good students. Half the time you spend in controlling the class than teaching. So there is a problem in our, at the same time we we are unable to accommodate. In fact, I was talking to one faculty member, and then I asked, okay, we I was basically trying to get a faculty member in education technology to be recruited. So I was trying to go and tell, you know, why don't you please recruit? And this person, I mean, they were not very happy. Later on, I met this person on the road, and this person said that they did research long time ago and concluded the ideal class size was 30. So I didn't tell them. So that is not the problem we are trying to solve. The problem we are trying to solve is, we have a large class. How do I teach it well? You cannot change the problem and say, no, no, I will teach only a small class. Okay. So it is important, given the large numbers of students to teach, not only here but throughout the country. Throughout the country, and we all believe that ICT based teaching methods are a good alternative to brick and mortar methods. That is the only way we can leapfrog and catch up with the developed world. Okay. If you have to rely on the same ratios, same building, same you know, everything that, let us say, US has or Europe has, it is going to take forever. We can't, our younger generation is impatient. We need to address their problems now. So I don't think there are any alternatives to, you know, using ICT based methods, because these can give good performance at a very low cost. But that we can, I mean, many of them, if you look at, are based on extra work to be done, not based on extra equipment, right? Important, given the large numbers of students to teach and shortage of good teachers, and more importantly, they can also make us better teachers. The teacher, myself, can become a better teacher. In fact, supposing I had asked this question, how do you compare my flipped class method versus my conventional class? I am sure the students will say, my flipped classroom method is better, because some people are not born gifted, right? When you teach, you make mistakes, you know, whatever, whereas when I use slides and, you know, so on and so forth, I can make sure that there are no mistakes. I can make sure that what I have in the slides also come in one word at a time, one formula at a time, one symbol at a time. You know, in fact, some people say that, oh, you should not use slides because writing on the board is better, because you can develop the idea slowly. So I always ask, who asked you to present the whole slide in one go? Why didn't you show one word? When I write an equation, I always say, okay, let's calculate the left hand side. Okay, only the left hand side appears. Okay, then I say that, okay, what symbol should come? What mathematical operation should we do? And they discuss, okay, integral, put an integral. Click, keystroke. After every keystroke, integral comes. Then formula comes. Then something comes. And then dx comes. Right? It's a lot more work preparing slides, but we have to do that. So you cannot say slides are bad. It's a very powerful tool. We are not using it properly. But then that makes sure that I don't make mistakes. I can make sure, I can spend enough time. In fact, I can remember what happened last year. Look, I made a mistake in that slide. So I correct it. I go through it, look, there is a mistake, I correct it and use it. So that way it allows me to become a better teacher. So it can allow, that's what I mean, it can, these methods, if used properly, can make us better teachers. So we must use this. In addition to lots of other things. Of course, flipped method, you don't believe this, okay. Better delivery, okay, whatever. I believe that my class, of course, I have not asked them, my conventional class versus my flipped classroom. But anyway, but the last point is very important, to be used wisely. These are all powerful weapons, but these are all two-edged, double-edged swords. If you don't use it properly, it will cut us. That is something that we have to be careful about. We have to validate our method. And in fact, when I teach this, some faculty members, I have given this talk to many people outside the IIT system also. They would ask, you know, how do I get permission? In IIT you can do this, I cannot do it outside in my college. So I always tell them, first do this for 1 hour. Do this for 1 hour and then go and convince your head of the department. Look, I did all this, so I believe that this is effective. So I believe that students haven't lost out. Please allow me to teach for a whole week. So it's a slow process. One has to make sure that things are going correct, right? So it has to be used wisely. I tell them that, you know, people will permit if you can convince them.
So the question is, I'm just trying to reconcile this fact, right? I look at every class delivered by instructor as a watching a drama unfold, right? And it's not the same every time. So that kind of becomes an interesting, exciting thing for students to watch. If you just watch a movie, then you know you don't have an attention span of 1 hour or whatever, and you are distracted by so many things. Maybe you will not absorb as much. So my question to you is, all the improvement that you're seeing, is it just because of these exams every week? I mean, if I incorporate that in my regular classroom, that every week I will have a quiz for 5 minutes about the previous two classes that I taught. And then that would keep them on their toes, and then would I suddenly see improvement in the scores?
No, that is not the reason. So the question is weekly quiz the reason why things are better? No, there is a fundamental difference. In a live class, if you look at the capability of students, it's a Gaussian distribution, right? And you have some students who are very good, some students very bad, and many average, okay? So at what speed do you teach them? Let me ask you that. No, I'm talking about your conventional class. Your question is, in a conventional class, supposing I were to teach, every day, every lecture could go in a slightly different direction depending on my experience in the previous one, what questions students asked and so on. So what is fundamental is being conventional. In a conventional class, that means you have to deliver live class. So at what speed do you teach? That is what is fundamental. So there, basically, if you choose your pace to be suitable for the brightest students, then there is a problem. Whatever speed you choose, there is a problem, right? So typically what happens is we become socialist somewhere in between, and so everybody is unhappy, right? Whereas in a flipped classroom, so that means whatever method you choose, there are enough people who don't understand, because it's a Gaussian distribution and you have to cover portion, you have to go at a particular speed. If you go too slow, some people will get demoralized, they will bored and they will get out. So you have to be on a fair clip, right? So there will be enough students who don't understand. Maybe they don't care about it, that's a different thing. Whereas in a flipped classroom, students can choose a speed of their learning, their liking, right? So it is better. No, you make them available. You are saying you will make available, do you think that the students will sit in the class 1 hour, they will also see the video and come to the next class? They haven't understood. I mean, if there is a quiz, they might prepare. Yeah, maybe. But I don't think if you have to do it every class, it's going to be a, it's worth trying. It's worth trying, but you seem to have concluded that there is no spontaneity in the flip method. First of all, the flip method itself was recorded live. The only problem is that you were not part of that experiment, that you are seeing somebody else's excitement. That's the only thing. But even here, what can happen is students ask a lot of questions. So then you find that, look, maybe you didn't explain something well. I have done that. Then I ask the cameraman to come to my class and say, I'm going to cover that portion. Gets recorded, made available, used next year. So it is possible to have the flipped classroom lectures, videos as the baseline and improve upon it.
Students nowadays come with their mobile phone, they will be doing something, they will record the lecture. No. So it's a regular lecture, so then they go back and listen. So this kind of thing would actually, I could do regular classes, people are just recording these lectures.
Yeah, students may record a live class and then they may go through it again. Yeah, so that is fine. Of course, this means that every student has so many parallel recordings and then going through it.
You are then jokingly saying that after some time the class will have only mobile phones and my video being played, I am not there, the students are not there.
Mm. You can argue that instead of 100 teachers, you know, I just need one person who makes the lectures. Correct. And makes them available. But what that does not include is that, you know, there's an in-class component as well. You still have tutorials, for want of a better word. You have weekly meetings, 1, 2, 3, whatever you consume them, where you come back and discuss the material which was on the video, or you come up with problems based on that material and then solve them. That's really where the learning happens. Right? You're now applying something that you sort of vaguely understood and now you have to work with it. So you still need people to conduct that. So you still need people who understand that material enough and can help the students go through it. So it's not, you can't get rid of instructors just by saying, you know, there are very
few videos available. Not at all, correct. Yeah, I didn't want to
go into that, but it is, yeah, quite true.
See, because I could just sit through your class if you make me attendance and 80% compensation. I could just sit here, play tic-tac-toe and not listen to you. And the conventional method is...
Conventional method? Yeah. So,
in fact, I remember when we were delivering lectures, when I was the head of CDEEP, there were a large number of courses that were getting streamed live. And I remember, I think chemical engineering class, Mahesh Patil taught that engineering. And the mid-semester exam, he gave the papers and Mahesh asked, who are you? I have never seen you. How come you are the topper? To which that fellow said, but I see you every day, because I was streaming. He was sitting in his class, hostel room, relaxing. And then, so there are what you say is quite true. The method has nothing to do with, whether it is live or flipped, doesn't mean that the students will watch. It has to be based on some other thing. Yeah, what is the point in making attendance compulsory when this fellow's mind is elsewhere, or we see some students sleeping? There are people who get very upset and say, no, wake up, or you get out. Get out means what happens to the attendance, okay? Then if you say no attendance, then he'll create trouble. Then if you allow him to sleep, come and sleep, you give attendance, then if he goes out, then he'll say, everybody will, you know, sleep. So you will send them out. So there is no actually correlation. Being in the class doesn't mean that their attention is, they're listening to us. Thank you.